we rented the DVD and settled into the living room for a family movie night. Instead of sitting on the furniture, we all sat on the carpet, Sonia, Cassie, and I leaning against the sofa. Colton and Colby perched on their knees in front of us, rooting for Aslan, the warrior lion, and the Pevensey kids, Lucy, Edmund, Peter, and Susan. The house even smelled like a theater, with bowls of Act II buttered popcorn hot out of the microwave sitting on the floor within easy reach. In case you haven't seen The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe, it is set during World War II when the Pevensey kids are deported from London to the home of an eccentric professor. Lucy, Edmund, Peter, and Susan are bored to death until Lucy stumbles on an enchanted wardrobe that leads into a magical kingdom called Narnia. In Narnia, not only can all the animals talk, but the place is also inhabited by other creatures, like dwarves, hobgoblins, and centaurs. The land is ruled by the lion Aslan, who is a good and wise king. But his archenemy, the White Witch, has cast a spell on Narnia so that it will always be winter, but never Christmas. Back in the real world, the Pevenseys are just kids. But in Narnia, they are princes and princesses who become warriors fighting on the side of Aslan. That night, as we were watching the final fantasy medieval battle scene, Colton, then six, was really getting into it as winged creatures dropped boulders from the sky and the battle-dressed Pevensey kids clashed swords with the White Witch's evil army. During the fight, Aslan sacrificed himself to save Edmund. But later, when he came back to life and killed the White Witch, Colton leaped to his feet and pumped his fist. He likes it when the good guys win. As the credits rolled up the television screen and Colby picked at the dregs of the popcorn, Sonia said offhandedly to Colton, "Well, I guess that's one thing you didn't like about heaven. No swords up there." Colton's giddy excitement vanished as quickly as if an invisible hand had wiped his smile off with an eraser. He drew himself up to his full height and looked down at Sonia, who was still sitting on the floor. "There are two swords in heaven," he said. Surprised at his intensity, Sonia shot me a sideways glance, then kind of drew her head back and smiled at Colton. Okay. Why do they need swords in heaven?"
"Mom, Satan's not in hell yet," Colton said, almost scolding. "The angels carry swords so they can keep Satan out of heaven."
Again, scripture leaped to my mind, this time from the book of Luke, where Jesus tells the disciples, "I saw Satan fall like lightning from heaven." And I remembered a passage from Daniel in which an angel visits Daniel in answer to prayer, but says he was delayed for 21 days because he was engaged in a battle with the king of Persia. Theologians generally take this to mean some kind of spiritual battle, with Gabriel fighting dark forces. I decided to lighten the mood.
"Hey, Colton, I bet you asked if you could have a sword, didn't you?" I said.
At that, Colton's scowl melted into a dejected frown, and his shoulders slumped toward the floor.
"Yeah, I did, but Jesus wouldn't let me have one. He said I'd be too dangerous."
I chuckled a little, wondering if Jesus meant Colton would be a danger to himself or others. In all our discussions of heaven, Colton had never mentioned Satan, and neither Sonia nor I had thought to ask him. When you're thinking heaven, you're thinking crystal streams and streets of gold, not angels and demons crossing swords. But now that he'd brought it up, I decided to press a little further.
"Hey, Colton," I said, "did you see Satan?"
"Yeah, I did," he said solemnly.
"What did he look like?" At this, Colton's body went rigid. He grimaced and his eyes narrowed to a squint. He stopped talking. I mean, he absolutely shut down, and that was it for the night. We asked Colton about Satan a couple of times after that, but then gave up because whenever we did, his reaction was a little disconcerting. It was as if he changed instantly from a sunny little kid to someone who ran to a safe room, bolted the door, locked the windows, and pulled down the blinds. It became clear that in addition to rainbows, horses, and golden streets, he had seen something unpleasant, and he didn't want to talk about it.
"Where's Pop buried?" he asked.
"Well, his body is buried in a cemetery down in Ulysses, Kansas, where Grandma Kay lives," I said.
Next time we're down there, I can take you to see where it is if you want. But you know that's not where Pop is. Colton kept peering out the window. I know, he's in heaven. He's got a new body. Jesus told me if you don't go to heaven, you don't get a new body.
Hang on, I thought, new information ahead.
Really? Was all I said.
Yeah, he said, then added, Dad, did you know there's going to be a war?
What do you mean? Were we still on the heaven topic? I wasn't sure.
There's going to be a war, and it's going to destroy this world. Jesus and the angels and the good people are going to fight against Satan and the monsters and the bad people. I saw it.
I thought of the battle described in the book of Revelation, and my heartbeat stepped up a notch.
How did you see that?
In heaven, the women and the children got to stand back and watch, so I stood back and watched.
Strangely, his voice was sort of cheerful, as though he were talking about a good movie he'd seen.
But the men, they had to fight. And Dad, I watched you. You have to fight too.
You said we're fighting monsters?
Yeah, Colton said happily, like dragons and stuff.
I'm not one of those preachers who camps out on end times prophecy, but now I remembered a particularly vivid section of Revelation.
In those days, men will seek death and will not find it. They will desire to die, and death will flee from them. The shape of the locusts was like horses prepared for battle. On their heads were crowns of something like gold, and their faces were like the faces of men. They had hair like women's hair, and their teeth were like lions' teeth. And they had breastplates like breastplates of iron. And the sound of their wings was like the sound of chariots with many horses running into battle. They had tails like scorpions, and there were stings in their tails. Their power was to hurt men 5 months. For centuries, theologians have mined these kinds of passages for symbolism. Maybe the combination of all those different body parts stood for some kind of country, or each one stood for a kingdom of some sort. Others have suggested that breastplates of iron indicate some kind of modern military machine that John had no reference point to describe. But maybe we sophisticated grown-ups have tried to make things more complicated than they are. Maybe we are too educated, too smart to name these creatures in the simple language of a child. Monsters. Colton, what am I fighting the monsters with?
I was hoping for a tank, maybe, or a missile launcher. I didn't know, but something I could use to fight from a distance.
Colton looked at me and smiled. You either get a sword or a bow and arrow, but I don't remember which.
My face fell. You mean I have to fight monsters with a sword?
Yeah, Dad, but it's okay, he said reassuringly. Jesus wins. He throws Satan into hell. I saw it.
And I saw an angel come down from heaven, having the key of the bottomless pit and a great chain in his hand. And he laid hold on the dragon, that old serpent, which is the devil, and Satan, and bound him 1,000 years, and cast him into the bottomless pit and shut him up and set a seal upon him, that he should deceive the nations no more, till the 1,000 years should be fulfilled, and after that he must be loosed a little season. And when the 1,000 years are expired, Satan shall be loosed out of his prison, and shall go out to deceive the nations which are in the four quarters of the earth, Gog and Magog, to gather them together to battle, the number of whom is as the sand of the sea. And they went up on the breadth of the earth, and compassed the camp of the saints about, and the beloved city. The fire came down from God out of heaven and devoured them. And the devil that deceived them was cast into the lake of fire and brimstone where the beast and the false prophet are, and shall be tormented day and night forever and ever. Colton was describing the Battle of Armageddon and saying I was going to fight in it. Also, Colton's nonchalance struck me. His attitude was kind of like, what's the problem, Dad? I've told you, I've skipped to the last chapter and the good guys win. That was some comfort, at least. We were just crossing the outskirts of Imperial when I decided to adopt his attitude toward the whole thing.
Well, son, I guess if Jesus wants me to fight, I'll fight, I said.
Colton turned away from the window, and I saw that the look on his face had turned serious.
Yeah, I know, Dad, he said. You will.
The scripture says that as Jesus gave up his spirit, as he sagged there lifeless on that Roman cross, God the Father turned his back.
I am convinced that he did that because if he kept on watching, he couldn't have gone through with it. Sometimes people ask, why Colton? Why do you think this happened to your family? I've had to say on more than one occasion, hey, we're just ordinary people from a one-horse town in Nebraska. The best we can do is tell you what happened to us and hope that you find it encouraging. Like the nurse in North Platte who maybe needed to see a miracle to believe there is someone greater than ourselves. Or the woman at Mountain View Wesleyan who needed a glimmer of hope to help her cope with her grief. Or Sonia, who needed salve on her own maternal wounds. Or like my mother, Kay, who after 28 years of wondering, finally knows she will one day meet her father again. Kids especially want to know whether Colton saw any animals in heaven. The answer is yes. Besides Jesus' horse, he told us he saw dogs, birds, even a lion. And the lion was friendly, not fierce. A lot of our Catholic friends have asked whether Colton saw Mary, the mother of Jesus. The answer to that is also yes. He saw Mary kneeling before the throne of God and at other times standing beside Jesus. She still loves him like a mom. When our church decided it was time for some serious prayer, church friends began making phone calls, and before long, around 80 people had driven over to Crossroads Wesleyan for a prayer service. Some were in our congregation and some from other churches, but they had all come together to pray for our son. Brad Dillon called me on my cell to tell me what was going on. What specifically can we pray for? He asked. Feeling a little odd about it, I told him what Dr. O'Halloran had said would be a good sign for Colton. So that night might be the only time in recorded history that 80 people gathered and prayed for someone to pass gas. Of course, they also prayed for a break in the weather so that we could get to Denver, and they prayed for healing, too. But within an hour, the first prayer was answered. Immediately, Colton began to feel better. That evening, he was able to use the bathroom. By the next morning, he was up in his room, playing as though none of this nightmare had ever happened. Watching him, Sonia and I couldn't believe our eyes. Except for being skinny, Colton was completely and utterly himself again. In less than 12 hours, we had cycled from completely desperate to completely normal. Around 9 a.m., Dr. O'Halloran came in to check on his patient. When he saw Colton up, smiling and chipper, and playing with his action figures, the doctor was speechless. For a long moment, he actually just stood and stared. Astonished, he examined Colton and then scheduled another round of tests to be triple sure that Colton's insides were on the mend. This time, Colton literally skipped all the way to the CT scan lab. We stayed in the hospital another day and a half just to be certain Colton's turnaround stuck. During those 36 hours, it seemed we had more nurses in and out than usual. Slowly, one at a time and in pairs, they would slip into the room, and each time their reaction was the same. They just stood and stared at our little boy. Before, when nurses visited our room, they'd check Colton's vitals and write stuff on charts. Now, they came with no medical business whatsoever, just stole glances at this little guy who only 2 days before was beyond their medical capabilities, but who now was up in his bed, chattering and playing with his new stuffed lion. During that time, one of the nurses pulled me aside. "Mr. Burpo, can I speak with you for a moment?" "Sure," I said. She indicated a room across the hall from Colton's room. "Let's step in here." Wondering what was up, I followed her into what appeared to be a small break room. She closed the door behind us and turned to face me. Her eyes held a deep sparkle as though something new had just blossomed inside her. "Mr. Burpo, I've worked as a nurse here for many years," she said. "I'm not supposed to tell you this, but we were told not to give your family any encouragement. They didn't think Colton was going to make it. And when they tell us people aren't going to make it, they don't." She seemed to hesitate for a moment, then she plunged on. "But seeing your boy the way he is today, this is a miracle. There has to be a God because this is a miracle." I thanked her for sharing with me, then said, "I want you to know that we believe this was God. Our church got together and prayed for Colton last night, and we believe God answered our prayers."